Up next, introducing our keynote and first speaker, Stuart McClung. He is the Program Planning and Control Office Chief of Staff for the Orion program at NASA's Johnson Space Center. He's worked on the Orion program crew service module office since 2006 and supported Orion in a number of leadership roles. Stu joined NASA in 1989 in the Orbiter Project Office at the Johnson Space Center, and through 2005, he served as project manager for the Space Shuttle Orbiter hardware upgrades and safety improvements, including the Orbiter docking system, external airlock, and the main landing gear. So let's give Stu a warm welcome.
Thank you very much. Quick mic check. That all sounds real good online? Okay, good. So just really brief, well, thank you for that intro. And thank you for inviting mechanical engineer. I am a mechanical engineer by trade. We were having some discussions yesterday that MEs might not be the favorite of some certain staffers here in the university. It was a pretty funny discussion. Chief of staff, just real brief, mechanical engineer by trade. I'm a hardware builder by experience and background. I started on a drafting board. Of course, it tells you how old I am. So I've released engineering. I've done a couple of tours in our headquarters office. Actually, got to write some congressional testimony a few times. I've done a stint in New Orleans and a stint at our facility at KSE as we've assembled vehicles. And so I think of myself as a generalist now. That colors my background and some of how I present things. So I'm a project office person. I came back from my last headquarters tour and they needed some help in what is basically our finance office. And so you got an engineer's eyes mixed in with the gang that's controlling the finance and the budget and the overall schedules, tried to herd the cats that are our engineers and our real experts, right? So I think of our office as an office that enables the real work that's going on. It's an important task. I like to tell people I got the second best job in the world. I still think the astronauts that fly on our vehicles have the coolest job ever. I get to help build the hardware that they use, and that's a really great thing to do, to come into work every day to get to do that. So we'll start. Where did I put the clicker? I just realized I set the clicker down, I'm sorry. This first video, and just for this audience, this video has a little bit of a flair for our supplier base. I think you might see that, right? It's targeted towards the industry that we all work with. So you get a little bit of that sense when the video runs. But it's got a really good overview of Orion and just the Artemis program in general, which Orion's a piece of. Has lots of good little factoids in it. So let's run that and then we'll keep going.
The twin sister of Apollo. We are returning to the moon. This is Orion, the only human-rated spacecraft in the world capable of deep space travel. And now, the Space Launch System. NASA's most powerful rocket since the Apollo era stands ready. Having undergone and passed numerous tests, the time has come to complete the journey. With hardware originating from every state in the nation and from partners around the world, Artemis 1 will be the first flight test of each of these components now assembled together. These two solid rocket boosters will provide more than 75% of the thrust necessary to leave Earth. Each booster stands 17 stories tall, a full segment more powerful than the SRBs of Shuttle. Together, these boosters are capable of 7.2 million pounds of thrust and will burn for the first 2 minutes of flight. The core stage, at 212 feet, is the tallest rocket stage NASA has ever built. With the rocket's flight computer secured inside, the core stage is designed to hold 2.3 million pounds of fuel. The 196,000 gallons of liquid oxygen and the 537,000 gallons of liquid hydrogen will combine to provide 8.5 minutes of propellant to the four massive RS-25 engines mounted below. As proven workhorses of the shuttle fleet, each RS-25 engine has a legacy all its own. Together, these four engines provide 2 million pounds of thrust, and with the SRBs, are capable of pushing Orion to a speed of 17,000 miles per hour. The interim cryogenic propulsion stage is a 45-foot tall upper stage that offers Orion nearly 25,000 pounds of thrust. Performing two separate burns, the ICPS will first raise Orion's orbit and then, later, propel it out on a trajectory to the moon. The ICPS is powered by a single RL-10 engine that will perform these two burns. This storied engine has propelled robotic missions to every planet in the solar system, including Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, the first space probes to reach interstellar space. Orion's service module, provided by the European Space Agency, is the powerhouse that fuels and propels Orion in space. It stores the spacecraft's propulsion, thermal control, electrical power, and critical life support systems, such as water, oxygen, and nitrogen. Orion's crew module is the pressurized segment of the spacecraft, where future crews will live and work on journeys to the moon. Capable of accommodating four crew members for up to 21 days, this capsule includes state-of-the-art avionics, innovative crew systems, and the largest heat shield of its kind for entry back into the Earth's atmosphere. Positioned at the top of Orion is the launch abort system, designed to pull the crew to safety in the event of an emergency, on the pad or during launch. Three solid rocket motors can activate in milliseconds, accelerating from 0 to 500 miles per hour in 2 seconds to propel Orion and crew safely away from the rocket. Now fully assembled, Artemis 1 stands at 322 feet. Artemis is no longer a series of separate parts and programs. United together, this is the first of Artemis's arrows, capable of ushering in the next chapter of human lunar exploration. Only together, this mighty system represents all that is possible, all that we are capable of when united around a stunning vision, with each component playing its part in a grander effort. We, the people of NASA and our partners, we, the people of the Artemis generation, all around this beautiful world, will bear witness to what we are capable of. Together, we are going back to the moon.
All right. Yeah, and so we've been to the moon, obviously, right? Agency's been there. The intent of Artemis, and I like to show this and also say, look at it, but don't go and memorize it, right? We're going back to the moon. The intent is to have a more sustained presence, both in orbit and on the surface, and then use that to evolve future, just future exploration, right? It's not going to happen immediately. Let's build up, let's go, and let's sustain it, and make it more sustainable, more supportable. And it's much more of a, the word community effort just came to mind. I'm not sure that's quite the right term, right? It was a big legacy program. It was Apollo, boom, big government legacy program. If you look at how Artemis is structured, much more international partnership and a bigger blend of what I'll call legacy programs and non-legacy programs. We'll have commercial suppliers coming in. I think you're going to see, I would use the pointer, but so that won't work for the folks online, right? So you'll see across the bottom conceptual ideas. You're going to have rovers, you'll have uncrewed, you'll have crewed vehicle, right? Artemis 3, the way Artemis 3 is structured today, you've got Orion flying out to the HLS, which is provided by SpaceX, right? And so you're having a an evolving mixture is, to me, is a really healthy thing, and for students, it's a really, really healthy thing because it's, you know, there's multiple opportunities to get engaged. And so you'll see how this works out. You know, Artemis 1 will fly. Our next launch attempt is November 14th. Actually, it's midnight, the 13th, going into the 14th. If my SLS friends have leaky hydrogen disconnects all fixed up, then we'll be ready to go. I've been in the MER. One of my side jobs is we have a room down the hall from the flight control team. Everybody's seen Mission Control and seen the pictures of Gene Kranz in his black tie way back in the day. We don't require white shirts and black ties anymore. Down the hall, we've got what we call the MER, which is our engineering support room. So that the flight control team's flying the vehicle. Yeah, I got the engineering team. We're there when there's an issue or looking ahead and in supporting that flight control team, trying to fine-tune test objectives on the missions, those types of things. So I'm one of the MER managers that has the pleasure of being involved in that. Orion's been good to go. I better not be jinxing myself, right? If I have an anomaly on the next time we power the vehicle up. But so we'll fly Artemis, uncrewed test flight, Artemis 2, we bring crew on board, Artemis 3, and that says Gateway. So there will be a vehicle out there today that's HLS. We'll rendezvous and dock with it, and then the programs continue on from that. And this is another, the next phase of that is the idea that this becomes a base camp. And so you fly out in Orion. I've joked that we're your Uber to the moon. That is not in the NASA talking points. I don't think we typically call it that, but it's your vehicle to out to the moon. We rendezvous, Orion stays in orbit. You go down, the crew goes down to the surface, do their science, do their exploration, come back, re-rendezvous, get back in Orion, and Orion's your vehicle back home. So I just like to use this because you can see lots of different stuff. To me, that's a really exciting aspect of the entire program. And just, I'll touch on this real quick. When you're designing a vehicle or a system, there's, low Earth orbit, and ISS is up there today. I worked on shuttle and ISS. Fantastic vehicle, great science going on all the time. If there's trouble, right, us engineers, when we're designing, you're looking at, all right, what are my failure modes? If the failure happens, what's time to effect? Do I have to recover? And when you put people in the mix, that changes that dynamic. How quickly can you recover? So if you're on ISS and there's a real problem and the crew's got to get home, you can climb into one of the waiting vehicles and punch off and get home in a couple of hours. Or if somebody were to happen to be injured, think of a medical scenario that comes along, right? Pretty quick. You get to the moon, you're at least 3 days away, so you start having to think greater autonomy for the crew and for the vehicle itself, where flight controllers and support team can't engage as much. And then eventually when we start talking Mars, and actually one of the things I liked about the Martian was they really had the aspect of the duration to get out and back accurate, right? 9 months to get there, right? Just the simple stuff of having enough food in place for 9 months is not a trivial thing, right? So if somebody in the audience can invent warp drive and get 9 months down to 9 days, that would be really, really handy, But so you get those kind of, those kind of realities to take care of and to work into your design. Right. Just a beauty shot from the first rollout. I was at the Cape about 4 weeks ago, and I actually had the opportunity to take a tour and go to the very top of the tower and look down on the rocket. Really, really cool event. It is hard until you're in person to appreciate just how big this thing is. Takes a lot of energy to get off the planet, get out to the lunar vicinity. Massive vehicle. Now I'll fuss at ourselves because we were talking in the lab yesterday about details of integration and design integration and how things get, what matters and doesn't matter. I'm not sure. So This is a clean pad, if you think about it. There's very few interfaces. One of the things we had to deal with, since we rolled back from to the hurricane, it got taken care of, but on the solid rockets, there's a range destruct system that, you know, if the vehicle happens to go off course, you can issue a command and you can destroy the vehicle. That's part of vehicle design. The batteries were reaching the end of their certified time. You can't access them on the pad. That little fine, and I wasn't, you know, I'm picking on my booster guys, you know. I'm sure that made sense in the design, in the process of that whole design iteration process. But had we stayed on the pad too much longer, we were going to have to roll back anyway to basically, you know, to recert, I won't say recharge. I'm not sure if I'm saying that accurately. But address the battery time and cycle as it related to range safety. So it's interesting, you know, those kinds of design details and interface details can really matter along the way, somewhere along the way. It's really interesting to make a trade early on, and then your figures of merit will be different early in your process than they are 2-3 years later when you're on the launch pad. And just a few more shots. On the right here at the very top, that's the launch abort system, crew modules underneath it. So these are all the different access towers in the VAB, the vertical assembly building down in Florida. For anybody who wants to be an intern, one of our interns made this graphic. Right. It does a nice expanded view, shows the launch abort system, crew module, and the service module. You'll see the pop-ups coming along the way. Before I got into this office, I had the opportunity to work on our explosive bolts. So there are 4 bolts that attach the crew module to the service module, 6 that attach the launch abort system to the rest of the stack, just me being a geek. The service module is an interesting aspect. You heard it talked about. That's, I think of it as the power plant. Most of it comes from the ESA Airbus Consortium. They provide that to us. But the solar arrays, for example, they come out of what used to be called RUAG, part of the ESA Airbus team. The actual solar cells are provided by a company out of, I think it's New Mexico. And so we provide them the cells. They assemble the solar array. The solar arrays are actually, and then the final assembly of all that is done back in Florida. The main engine is a NASA-provided product that goes to them. They integrate it, test it, make sure it's ready to go, bring it back to us. So it's a very blended vehicle. And you're blending it not just across facilities and centers, but across countries. And so that teaming, that learning each other's communication styles, those types of things matter. My go off on a tangent, quick story. I worked with the Russians a lot when I was working on the shuttle program. We bought our docking mechanisms from them. That's how we flew up to the Mir and to ISS. I was discussing Orion one day and was talking about the vehicle shape. And I had made a point, I had learned with an international partner to not assume they understood acronyms, you know, and to spell things out. The vehicle shape we refer to as the outer mold line, right? The OML is the outer mold line. That's a, to me in my brain, that's a typical aerospace term. My interpreter rattled that off and everybody in the room was laughing. And she was an English, you know, English major, if you want to call it that. She was a language trained specialist. She heard mold and converted it to fungus. And I was like, what's funny about the OML? And they're like, how come you have mushrooms? You know, and we lost 10 or 15 minutes in the meeting trying to sort that out, but, you know. Well, let me keep going. All right, so this is just another shot of it. Like I said, the abort motor, really impressive. There's a video online from Pat Abort 1, and the video captured it right. And that's sized. The pad abort one test took it from sitting on the launch pad or on the ground in New Mexico to a mile in orbit in about 2.5 seconds. Puts about 12 G's of acceleration into the astronaut's chest. So they don't necessarily pass out, but they're also not doing any flying. There's just no way to be doing reliably doing switch throws when your arms are getting tossed back into your seat. It's actually the motor is sized, assuming you're in first stage ascent and the rocket underneath goes unstable. And so it's got to take this crew module, which weighs about 25,000 pounds at liftoff, and outrun an accelerating fireball. That's the simple way to describe what its job is, and get it vertically away and horizontally away, and then prepare the vehicle for a typical parachute landing. And I think this is one of my, it's very interesting. That's a solid rocket motor that has 8 nozzles, and there's a pintle inside that goes through a pre-programmed sequence that pivots it around, and this is really how you're steering it. You're getting it up and away, and the jet firing routine coming off the nose, which is, you know, just pure vectors and forces doing its thing, actually pulls it up and away, pivots it around, and then gets the vehicle back ready to give the crew a landing. And that's this is the integrated thing. And we talk about 4 crew for 21 days. So 16 feet in diameter is about the inside of the mock-up of the vehicle is about the front of the room here. So I always like when I'm doing a tour at the Cape or at the Cape back home in Houston, if you got 4 people, it's like, do you like your 3 friends well enough? Because it's a snug, you know, it's a snug trip. It's actually a very roomy vehicle by comparison. The Soyuz that people went back and forth to ISS in, very tight quarters. So it's really, by comparison, very roomy. In reality, so the 4 crew 21 days is a sizing thing related to consumables and how you're going to deal with power and just all the other consumables on board. Typical mission is going to be you launch 3-4 days, depending on how the rendezvous is going to set up, and then you're going to dock to whatever the target is out in lunar vicinity, and then the vehicle powers down and goes quiescent. So there's not a mission on the books today where we have 4 people sitting in there boring holes in space for 21 days. It's a sizing requirement that we work off of. And I always like this map. And again, we use this, it shows everybody that's involved in this. So it's a bit of a supply chain map. The big stars are like the Marshall facility in Alabama, Houston, and whatnot. I've worked with a number of students across the states, and it does a good job of, you know, like I work with people that always wanted to be in Houston. That was the end of it. They were going to work at NASA, period. There's a lot of opportunities in the world to come be involved in this. And if you don't like Texas because we have really hot, nasty summers and big mosquitoes, right? There's other parts of the country and other parts of the world to be involved in. Like here in Oregon, I call it the flower pot, the piece of structure that attaches our parachutes to the structure of the crew module is actually cast at a company out in Redmond and then machined, I think it's across the river here at Cascade Machining, just basically right here in Portland. There's an electronics house south of the city, and Near Space out in Tillamook provided a cover that was used as part of crew transportation. So there's right in your backyard, there's hardware that's getting ready to go to space. Your satellite beat us, but we're bigger. But so anyway, yeah, so it's really pretty interesting. These maps are also, if you were to do a map of basically the aircraft industry or the defense industry, you'd see a ton of overlap, right? Our life support system, the ECLS system, a lot of that comes out of Colorado, right? They make really good cold plates. They've been doing it for a long time. They do pumps, they do fans, they, you know, there's, we lost 1 week of a schedule a while back because they had one in, you know, their senior welder who'd been working 6 months, 6 days a week, took a week vacation. And they don't, you know, we're not a big customer, so we don't, team, you know, companies don't have lots and lots of people lined up to do space work, because you'll come in and you'll build twos, threes, fours, right? So you don't have, you know, production teams of 50 sometimes, so you'll have an expert. But anyway, I just mentioned all that because it's, there's, from an opportunity perspective, the world's pretty open. And this is just the map of our European, the European teams. And you can see they're very comparable. Most of the work, the assembly is done in Bremen, Germany. The structure comes out of Italy. And you can see they've actually reached back to the U.S. for some of their suppliers. I will highlight, we're under USA where it says valves. Propulsion valves are challenging. If you got an interest in being a propulsion engineer, there's a lot of opportunity there too. That's, we had them on shuttle. They're, you know, they got to be small. They do. They've got to work when they've got to work. You don't want them to leak, right? They are finicky animals. It's a really key piece of the system. And we've all been challenged with them over the last couple of years. So if you're, that's a good opportunity as well. All right, here's our path so far. We flew paddleboard one and ascendant two right there. Those have both been done and completed. Those were really the test flights, and we did them with simulated capsules to prove that launch abort system is ready to do its job. So it's really done, it's qualified and completed. Ascent Abort 2 actually took advantage of a soon-to-be retired, I think it was a Minuteman missile that we got from the Air Force, and took advantage of it. It had sufficient thrust to get us onto test condition. EFT-1 back in 2014 was a good first system-level test of the vehicle. Big change between EFT-1 and Artemis-1. One of the most obvious changes is the heat shield, which was mentioned in the opening video. Again, largest heat shield. Clearly, we've been to the moon before. We do reentry. We've done lunar velocity reentry before, but not with this scale of a vehicle. So it's not something that's scalable. We use Avcoat as our material, just like Apollo did. We looked at about 8 different options, went back and forth, settled back on Avcoat. But still, you need to run this system-level test to make sure that what we've done in the lab, that our modeling is right, that our heating models are right, our ablation rates are that we've all predicted are correct, and basically prove that out on Artemis 1. You know, it's not the kind of thing that's a good scalable. There is no textbook out there, and when you're starting to talk about human flight and guaranteeing that I get to bring them back home, Artemis 1's going to give us that final check mark. And then we've actually got hardware in production up through Artemis 5. Artemis 2 vehicle, the crew module and service module are in Florida already. Artemis 3 structures in Florida. Artemis 4 structures in New Orleans, and some of our avionics components for Artemis 5 are being built around the country. So that's a pic, just a static shot from paddleboard 1. I think it's 25,000 pounds or so. We could probably sell tickets to that one, you know, get people to sign up and ride that. It's pretty exciting stuff. EFT-1. We launched 1 day late. A boat came into the exclusion zone. You know, it is very well known and defined, hey, we're getting ready to launch this vehicle, don't fly, or don't fly, don't run your boat, don't whatever, stay out of this zone. Somebody didn't fly that day, or didn't pay attention, so we actually stood down and delayed a day. It turned out to be handy. There's a really cool video. I'm sure the management was not happy. had we launched the first day, the aircraft that was going to record the reentry and the parachute deployment and all that sequence got grounded due to ground fog, couldn't take off. And so we would have lost some really cool entry video. Since I'm an entry person, I was, you know, I'm not heartbroken. Yeah, so fascinating thing, you know, things that pop up along the way. And then that's SN abort two that we flew just a couple of years ago. I'm gonna, I'll talk over this for a little bit, cut it short. Again, another intern-generated product. This is just some clips to show what the mission's going to do. I do like to point out the solar arrays. The solar arrays have to be in specific locations and locked in place depending on which engine you're firing to deal with the potential for heating and or structural interface loads on the solar arrays. We've got cameras on each solar array, on the tips of them, and so one of the things we hope to get during the mission is a really good selfie of the vehicle with maybe the Earth rise in the background, or certainly the moon in the background, depending on vehicle orientation. Each chute, just fun factoid, each chute's 116 feet in diameter. I've always thought it's, like I said, the part of me is like, this, it's really cool, right? You're coming back from lunar velocity, 25,000 miles an hour-ish, right? Trade speed for heat, surf through the atmosphere is the way I like to say it, and decelerate. And the heat shield hits temperatures 3,000-4,000 degrees Fahrenheit as you decelerate. Get to about 50,000 feet, and we prep, and then at about 35,000 feet, we start the parachute sequence. By the time you start the parachute sequence, you're down to 350 miles an hour, right? So you've gone from 25,000 to 350. We splash down at about 20 miles an hour, 25 feet per second, 18 miles an hour, I think it is, on a normal mission. So just a really fun, you know, like I look at that and it's like, dang, that's cool. Of course, then I watch movies like Star Trek or Star Wars where they zap, fly back and forth in their little fighters from the Earth up to the, you know, to the mothership back and forth. And it's like, it's not quite physics, but it's cool, you know. So living within physics, this is really cool. And so this is just pictorially what we're doing. About 60 miles off the surface, we will, depending on the launch day, the mission duration will be anywhere from 26 to 42 days. And we'll come back, we'll launch in Florida, we land off the California coast, basically just off of Baja, weather alternates actually further north, fairly close to the Catalina Islands and the San Diego area. So this gives you a quick idea of what the Artemis 1 mission looks like. We've got a good 100 or so test objectives. He said the heat shield being one of the key ones. But as we tick through the mission, the flight team and the engineering team will be working through. And this is, it's like, let's give this thing one last really good test flight. I like to say to prove to ourselves that we're as smart as we think we are. Right? And because it is really important to find that out before Artemis 2 and we go put the crew in. And that's just a shot of the vehicle from a couple of months ago back in Florida. You see the crew module sitting on top. The solar arrays, two of the four solar arrays there, they are folded up and stowed. And the two dark black objects you see on the side are two of the three fairings. The fairings encapsulate the service module. They're actually part of the structural path going uphill, and they're protecting the solar arrays from aerodynamic buffeting going along as well. They're jettisoned as we get early on in ascent. Launch abort system there. And that was the roll when we rolled out to the out of the VAB. That's Orion fully ready to go to be set on top of the SLS. And that's some shots from when we were mating and stacking the vehicles. Another shot of rollout. You can tell we're kind of proud. We can't help it. And there's just another shot. It's really fairly interesting. Just the intricate details that go into something like those, the QDs that are mated up that provide, whether it's electric or fluid or purge air or whatever, that have to have to separate and be pulled away at the moment of launch, right? So there's folks that have entire careers built up around making sure, those quick disconnects make their do their job. And there we go. We've got an experiment going on. Got a couple of mannequins that are loaded up with body, with a tissue that looks like the human, and doesn't look like, but represents the human torso, human body. And they're filled up with radiation sensors. One gets a radiation vest, one doesn't. Right? So when we, unlike ISS, get to lunar vicinity, you've cleared the Van Allen radiation belts. This will give us a really good, not just us, but basically everybody that's involved in Artemis will have advantage of this data. Take a look. Here's what's going on. Here's what the measured radiation environment looks like in that part of the mission. Here's your Artemis 2 shot, right? Similar. This will have crew on board. One of the key things we'll do down here in the lower right is demonstrate our new rendezvous and proxops sensor suite. Clearly, we know how to rendezvous and dock. We do that on ISS all the time. You get out in the lunar vicinity, there's a different risk factor, right? You've gone and you can't just come home, or you do not want to push a payload all the way to the moon and then unsuccessfully dock because you're going to toss it off into deep space and lose it. Really, really, really screws up the whole docking sequence. And so we'll do this rendezvous and docking demonstration on Artemis 2. It'll be one of the key test objectives. And so there's some shots at the Cape from the vehicle being worked on. That was the service module in Bremen before it got shipped over to Florida. Another shot of it. Here's a heat shield. This is the heat shield upside down, if you want to think about it. Put that white paint on it now. It comes off fairly quickly. It's a thin layer that makes just enough of a difference in thermal management on orbit that it's now part of the design configuration. And there's the launch abort system. Artemis 3 mission. Now you get into some really complicated and complex rendezvous sequencing, right? Artemis 3, the HLS will already be out there, will be in the NHRO, I have a hard time saying that, NHRO orbit. It'll be out there. We fly out, rendezvous, dock, and then you transfer out of the docked vehicle, and they go down to the surface. Come back, re-rendezvous. So the sequencing and the timing of the rendezvous and mission planning becomes really, really critical. Since you've got to make sure you're dealing with propellant consumables and all of those other aspects of it. You know, it's going out and loitering for a while becomes very problematic, so you don't necessarily want to do that. And there's the pressure vessel that will become the crew module that'll do that mission. That's down in at the Michoud facility. A bunch of 2219 and 2195 alloys that get welded together to form the vehicle structure. Another shot of it after it's been moved down to Florida, and it goes from that green structure, and they start populating it, hanging harnesses and tubes, the plumbing, thrusters, et cetera, off of it. Lockheed makes our crew module adapter. That's the structure that the ESM gets inserted into. And so this piece of structure plus the European hardware then becomes a service module. And that's an early version of the service module. Whoever builds up avionics schematics, if they get it wrong, this would become a problem. You can tell right early on it is key to get that part of the design right, because it's a very complex integrated beast that's out there, right? And you don't want to have that done and then get to the end and realize once you've got something buried that you have to back out and go back in and touch it and make a correction. And that's the heat shield flipped around. That's the Artemis III heat shield coming out of the autoclave, I think, up in Denver. Artemis IV mission looks like three. Right now, the plan for Artemis IV is, if you see that note 7 up there, we will have what Orion calls a co-manifested payload. The HAB will put it on our nose, and we push it out to the moon and leave it out there, and you start assembling the gateway. And then the mission continues on. Structure, more baby pictures. And I'll quickly go through testing. We build a structural test article vehicle, right? This shape is very complex. And so to get the loads right, well, to know that we've got the loads right, we built the structural test article, took it up to the lab, the Lockheed facility in Denver, pushed, pulled, shook it, did all kinds of things, and then fed that back to our analyst, and had strain gauges and accelerometers installed and said, all right, did the load path behave the way I thought the load path would behave? And so this was an extensive test program to prove that out. That's a test of the three fairings. The timing of getting them separating and the pyrotechnics operating properly is really quite critical, and so this was just the final fairing test that we did with the structural test article. And then this is a lab in Denver, which is replicates the entire command and control system of the vehicle. And so you take our really smart software folks, put it up there and say, hey, it's all wired up, the vehicle knows how it's going to behave, and then you start imparting failures. It's like, all right, let's assume this box fails. How does the system react? Does it react the way we expect it to react? And so you use a lab like this and put evil people in charge to come up to dream up failure scenarios and combine failure scenarios and feed that in. And so you use it to understand vehicle design and you use it to feed into the team training for the operators. Out in White Sands, the Easton Airbus team, well, all of us were out there and ran a full-up propulsion system test. And part of what I worked on ahead of time was doing parachute drop tests. We would do these out at Yuma Proving Ground. We would take a full-scale vehicle, put it in the back of a C-17, get the C-17 up to 35,000 feet, extract it out, let the sequence, let gravity do its thing, and we ran a series of 25 tests. Some, like, here's a nominal test where I got three good shoots. Sometimes I would run one where I had two out of three, or I would have one that came out late, had a reefing line. So we went through logical failure scenarios and tested all of those. Again, in a big giant shoots like this, when you deploy them, it's not like, parachutes and soft goods behave in a repeatable manner. So you have to do enough testing to get your reliability up high enough to say I'm comfortable with using this system. Water impact testing, again, to verify, because we know we're going to land in the water, how do the loads of hitting the water impart themselves into the vehicle, right? We have the requirement to make sure the crew is safe, but we also work to make the vehicle as light as we can while we meet safety margins. And so really understanding how your loads are transmitted feeds into that process. And then this is just our get off the stage page, all the different ways you can follow us. We have some really talented non-engineers that handle our communication, because most of us aren't that good at telling good stories. And so it's just not part of our training, right? And so if you're not following us, I encourage you to. Anything that you find on here is public domain, and so you can use it and feel free to use it. And I think, this is my last, right? I think it's a great program. NASA has really two intern, you hear about Pathways and you hear about OSTEM. Both are really good. They can do some really interesting work. It's a really good avenue to get into NASA, if NASA is your goal. At the same time, there's a lot of the companies that are in our business and in our supply chain that also have their internships. So again, if you don't want to come to Houston or you can't do something that's remote, do something local, look for comparable types of work. But the internship goes a long way to helping a student get some experience they can put on the resume, and also do some work that says, hey, I liked this, or, oh, no, I didn't. You know, find that out early so you can modify your path if you need to. And I think that's it. Any questions? Questions in here, questions online? Go ahead.
How would you characterize the Russian interest and presence in space in general?
I don't know how to answer that right now, really, with current political, with the world situation going on, what's happening in the Ukraine. It is interesting. I mean, right, we've partnered with them starting in 93 and have been working jointly with them ever since. Push the politics aside, at the engineering and the technical community level, it's still strong. It's been really good. We actually complement each other pretty well in skill set and capability. So that part of it has been, I mean, I have some great friends that live in Moscow. I thought their design team was excellent. I can't help but be worried about how the Ukraine situation, how that might or might not affect us. They are not actively involved in Artemis at this point in time. I'm sure that's a byproduct, right? We are actively flying ISS jointly right now. So we're working just like normal, I guess, just like normal in low Earth orbit, but they're not part of the Artemis deep space program at this point in time. That's probably about as best I can do. I think it's interesting. I was telling some of the students yesterday, my first meeting over there in 93, the first day it was Americans on one side of the table, Russians on the other side of the table, and on day two it was blended engineers on one side of the table and blended management on the other side of the table. And it's like, just like you'd have at any other, and everybody yelling at each other about how dumb management was or how annoying the engineers were. It was in both languages. And so that kind of stuff happened very organically, solved itself. I do think that we're a good avenue, right? Peaceful space exploration is a great, I mean, I'm getting all soft and smushy here, right? It is a great avenue for countries to work jointly together. Space exploration is hard and expensive, and it, in my brain, when you have multiple countries, multiple cultures doing it, and doing it blended. So I'll get off my speechy soapbox. Go ahead.
I'll just say I totally agree. It always makes me feel better to see people from around the world working together.
Right.
When it comes to stuff like the
Yes, and then Artemis 2, the goal is to get Artemis 2 at the end of 2024. Personally, I think it'll drift, because just knowing what has to happen between 1 and 2 and some of the hardware linkages, that'll be really, really difficult. And then the thought was, like, one-year cycles, basically one-year increments after that. So 24, 25, or call it January 1 of 25, yeah. January 1 of 26. And we have internal schedules, and then we have external commitments. So it's that kind of time frame. Artemis 3 will be interesting, right? Because, again, it's not just is Orion and SLS ready, but is the HLS ready and in place? And we'll have the discussion. We might have, and I just haven't been, you know, part of it. Like, how long does HLS need to be there and need to be in orbit, and say, hey, I am ready and good to go before we would go launch Artemis 3, right? You're not going to do it on back-to-back days. Right. Well, you couldn't anyway, but you know, you wouldn't. You want to know that your target vehicle is healthy and ready to accept you. Right, so you get those kinds of complexities that'll get worked into the actual sequencing of it. But so yeah, it's that mid-20s. Some of that always comes back to, well, we got to get the first one done, right? We got to execute, which is key for us, right? Let's do this, prove it. And then staffing as well. It's like, you know, how much can I ramp up, you know, or maybe not ramp down, right? What's my level that I can keep, you know, keep pressing my supply chain at and our own internal team. So.
Cool. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So I guess arguably one of the biggest technologies kind of coming on the space scene right now is kind of reusability.
Right.
You know, having all these reusable parts that you can, you know, bring back to the ground from orbit, dock, use again, you know, reuse, reduce. And I know kind of one of the biggest sort of things right now is integrating that into space as much as possible. Are there any sort of plans to integrate that into future Artemis missions or to possibly work with privatized contracted companies to look into that more? Or what's kind of the...
Yeah, I'm trying to go back to a picture I want to talk of off of. We are actively, I want to go back to the...
Because if I understand it correctly, as of right now, right. There's no parts on the Artemis at all that are planning to be returned back to ground.
No parts of SLS?
Yes.
Okay, no parts of SLS. I mean, the core tank is not, it would be really, really complicated. I mean, you could. The shuttle boosters were reflown. The boosters for SLS originally were going to be reflown and reused, and now they're not. A lot of that ended up, we find what's happening in reuse and how that's, and I'll get to Orion here in a minute. Pretty interesting, right? When you start maximizing ascent performance, reuse is one of the things that goes away, right? And low Earth orbit versus deep space, different figure of merit, right? And so, for the boosters, just to shed mass, to shed up mass, reuse and like the parachutes that were going to be used were taken out of the design. That's fairly long ago history. Orion was not originally planned for reuse. Again, some of that was mass driven, some of that was just looking at it, but it's evolved quite a bit. Clearly the service module is not, right? The service module stays with us, like in the video, till about 20 minutes before entry interface and burns up. We're actually reusing some avionics off of Artemis 1 on Artemis 2. That was actually budget driven. But from there on out, Starting with Artemis 2 and 3 and on, most all of the avionics do get reused. The primary structure will also, and like the propulsion systems, will be reused at a less frequent interval. So it's evolving as part of how we've reduced our production cost for the outgoing, the out years, is to add reuse back in. Now, what we ended up having to do there is, like, say you take a capsule, I'll go back to propulsion and the thrusters, right? Thrusters are a pretty finesse thing. I'm going to splice them down in salt water, right? I'm going to land, I'm going to splice them, and I'm going to get salt water in the throat of a thruster chamber. I mean, I want to use it again, right? And so the people up in, probably up in up in Seattle are like, okay. And so you're going to go through the work to say, all right, how do I know I've got this thing good and clean and test? And you will get better. And as we evolve, we'll say, you know what? Maybe thrusters wasn't a good idea. It's just too expensive to clean it, retest it, prove that it's really good. It's just cheaper to build new ones. But so, yeah, the vehicle will get reused to some extent, right? And that'll evolve. I must admit, the reuse that's going on, particularly in low Earth orbit, really fascinating, right? That has changed the dynamic of the discussion within the whole industry.
For sure. So at least, yeah, for right now, in terms of deep space exploration, it's definitely not a super tuned focus right now, as more of just proof of concept, making sure everything works, and maybe further on down the line.
Then you evolve into it, right? We've actually, within the last 6 months, looked at, could we do an air capture of the launch abort system after it jettisons off, right? And so you saw the size of the launch abort system. At the moment, it's just a really big lawn dart. And so you have to put some kind of a drogue chute on it to make it a slow lawn dart so that you could actually capture it safely, right? But so some of those discussions have been going on. So.
Looks like we're almost about out of time for questions. So.
Okay. So you're throwing me off the stage?
A little bit.
Okay.